Hi, this is Kara from the National Young Farmers Coalition, and I'm going to give a very quick little video about crop insurance and some things that farmers might want to know about crop insurance. So we've been working with Cornell on this grant to help New York State farmers understand what kinds of crop insurance options are available to them, and we've been specifically focusing on whole farm revenue protection. I did a little video about that last year, and it is still on our website, and I will link to it in this blog. But I also wanted to cover some other crop insurance areas just to see if there might be people that are interested in that. So I'll give an overview here of some crop insurance products. I think the first thing that's helpful to understand is that what is traditionally called crop insurance is covered by RMA, the Risk Management Agency, and that's under USDA. So USDA has all kinds of programs under it. One is RMA. Another one is FSA, which oversees NAP. NAP is the Non-Insured Crop Disaster Assistance Program, and it is a program that's available to cover crops that don't usually have crop insurance policies. FSA oversees commodity programs as well. So those are other risk management tools that some growers use, but we are going to be talking today about RMA and products under RMA. So what's crop insurance? Basically, crop insurance is around to help farmers and ranchers to manage risk. You pay an annual premium, so just like any other insurance policy, you would pay a premium to buy that policy, and then you purchase the policy from a crop insurance agent. So you're not purchasing it from the USDA, you're purchasing it from an independent agent. And I'll link in the blog to where you can find agents like that. And then if your yield or your revenue falls below the level to which you have insured it because of some covered cause, and the covered cause kind of depends on which product you've bought, you can receive an indemnity payment. So this is pretty in line with other kinds of insurance that we buy. One of the insurances that you are most likely to have experience with is car insurance. I sadly have had some car insurance payouts, but so you pay a premium to your car insurance provider, and then when something bad happens, you file a claim, they come out, they check it out, and then they pay you some indemnity payment. Like car insurance, you can pay different levels for crop insurance. So you can pay more to have more coverage, or you can pay a lower level to have a more basic level of coverage. And so in thinking about what kinds of coverage to buy, most crop insurance products are available at a catastrophic level or a very low level, and that's the cheapest option. Some of the products, they have completely free coverage, but then they have an administration fee. So that coverage is free because the government is subsidizing it. But then they are pretty basic coverage. So they only really provide a payout or an indemnity payment if the grower has lost, say, half or more of that harvest, either by yield or revenue, however you've insured it. So that's a pretty bad year if you've lost half. So that might be coverage that you're unlikely to necessarily see payouts for. But on the other hand, it's covering your risk in a catastrophic way, and there isn't a premium, or there, you know, the coverage is free. Instead, if you wanted to have more coverage, you could choose to buy up or to purchase more coverage. So the car insurance example would be like, you might have coverage on your car, but you might not carry collision coverage, so that if something happened to your own vehicle and it was your own fault, you might not have coverage. So you can choose to buy up and have better coverage. In this case, in many of these crop insurance policies, you can cover up to 85% of your yield or revenue. That's often the highest level of coverage you can get. So then if you had some loss of about 15% or more, you would be able to have an indemnity payment or a payout. And the amount, as you might guess, of the premium that the government subsidizes decreases as your coverage increases. So you're not subsidized as heavily at this 85% coverage level as you would be at the 50% coverage level where the government is almost entirely subsidizing it. And it's really, it's a little bit of a gamble and a little bit about your level of risk tolerance to decide what kind of coverage you want and what feels right for your farm. So you want to think about, you know, how risky is it where you're growing, and just kind of consider your personal experience and what kind of buy-up level you might want. And of course, that's a financial decision as well. This picture is from Ag Analytics, which is a website that was developed at Cornell, and we will link to here as well, that really helps you, helps growers to have a clearer picture of crop insurance policies that are available to them. Because these products are sold through crop insurance agents, usually you need to go to the crop insurance agent in your area to get a sense of whether, like, exactly what's available and how much it'll cost and what's your premium and how much is subsidized and stuff like that. The Ag Analytics website helps you to do some of that evaluation on your own. So this is just an example. This is a commodity, this for commodity corn in Washington County, New York. But this is just, I think, illustrating, for me, I'm kind of a visual learner, this is a catastrophic level of 50%. So you would have to, the farmer would have to lose more than 50% of their yield in order to, of their yield or their revenue to receive a payout at this level. But then you can see that the premium is quite low. And that just continues this curve up until at your very highest premium price, you're receiving an 85% coverage. So hopefully that kind of paints a graphic picture of that premium and coverage conversation. So the type of crop insurance that is kind of most common is this single crop or multi-peril insurance. And so this is when a farmer will buy a crop insurance policy for just one crop. And this slideshow was made for New York because that's the state where this grant is funded. And this is a list of what's available, what kinds of single crop insurance policies one can buy in New York. So for barley, corn, forage, sorghum, and then for some vegetable commodities as well, and a few fruits. So I think this, and these are available, this changes a little bit by county. So these policies could be available in your county, but they may not be. And these single crop or multi-peril insurances can be for either yield or for revenue. And so that's, I think, also important to understand. And so you see that while a small diversified vegetable grower may grow some cabbage and may grow some fresh green beans and some potatoes, that this kind of insurance has traditionally really been geared toward larger commodity growers, people who are growing acres and acres and acres of onions. And I try not to dive too deeply into this because I think this is probably not the policy that is most helpful for smaller, more diversified growers. But these policies, these multi-peril policies, can be based on the production, can be based on the yield or revenue that's average for that county, for the county in which you are growing, but they can also be based on actual production history. And so that's a crop policy that that is covering your losses when you drop below the level that you have historically proven. So that could be because of drought or flood or fire or wildlife. It could be even because of plant or insect disease, insect pressure or plant disease, if you are actually doing your due diligence to try to control those things. So if you've experienced any of those losses and you have a much lower yield or revenue than you have in other years, based on documentation that you've kept, then you can potentially receive a payout or an indemnity payment. This is for yield risk, not for price risk. So if you traditionally grow cabbage and the price of cabbage falls, that is not covered under this policy. And if you just lose a buyer or you fail to market your cabbage completely, that is also not covered. And if you have insect or pest or deer pressure and you do nothing about it, that is also not necessarily covered. So you need to be doing your due diligence to make sure that you're taking care of your crop. So that's probably not the policy that's going to apply to many of you. But there are some other policies that may be pretty helpful to know about. So there is an RMA product called Pasture, Rangeland, Forage. Or PFR. This policy, the date for this policy, I think that one needs to buy it for is in the fall, which is different than some of the other ones, but I think it's November 15th. And this is about precipitation. So pasture rangeland forage can be a useful tool for farmers or ranchers to protect against a lack of snow or rainfall. And it's relative to historic levels in a specific geographic region. So USDA divides the country into these grids, and then they track precipitation in any of those given grids. And if you are enrolled in this program and the precipitation in that area drops below a historic level, then you're automatically sent a payment. And that is really easy because it doesn't require you to be doing any of the data collection or any of the record keeping. It then can allow you, if you are, say, like in this picture, grazing cattle on grass and you have to buy in winter feed, or you need to be buying in forage for those cows because it's been so dry that there's not adequate forage for them out in the fields, that you can cover some of that cost. One of the things to consider when thinking about this is, as I'm sure all of you know, rainfall or snowfall can be very specific to can just be very specific based on exactly where you are. So if the grid is large enough, this USDA grid system, if the grid in your area is large enough and maybe the USDA tracking area is a little further from your farm and that area has higher rainfall or just catches a couple summer storms or something like that, you still may not get an indemnity payment even if you have experienced less rainfall. So that's just something to keep in mind. So I will also link to a tip sheet about PFR in this blog. I think PFR can be a really useful tool, and it's certainly quite easy because you don't have to do any of the data collection or any of the record keeping. There are also some insurance options for beekeepers. So there's this API or apiculture crop insurance policy that's through RMA as well, which is like pasture rangeland forage, in which it insures against drought or low precipitation. application. That hasn't been heavily used, but it can be a useful tool. And then there are beekeepers who are using whole farm revenue protection, which we will talk about in a minute as well. One thing to know is colonies are insured as a, like, beekeepers insure colonies rather than acres of land, because that is how we think about our bees. And I think that there's also a great tip sheet on beekeeping. So this is the front and back of that tip sheet that's provided by Cornell. And this compares those specific crop insurance policies, the apiculture crop insurance and whole farm revenue for beekeeping. And then it also has two other potentially useful programs that are managed by FSA. So that's a great thing to know if you're a beekeeper. And then the blog post that I did last year also involved a video in which I dove a little deeper into whole farm revenue protection. I think that this is definitely a program that is geared towards smaller, diversified growers, and is the crop insurance program that works best for those people if there's something that does work really well for them. So this is, I think, a place where you should pay attention. So if I'm going to go over this quickly, and if it works, if you think, huh, I'd like to know more about that, then I will link to the video that we made last year. So whole farm revenue protection is a pretty new policy, and it's really in response to the fact that a lot of the other RMA products didn't work well for CSA farmers or farmers market farmers, people who are growing not just three crops, but, you know, 40 crops and 350 plantings of things. So this is a RMA product that's really geared toward farmers like that. And that is, I think, common in the farmers, in the National Young Farmers Coalition. We have a lot of diversified direct market produce growers. So this product insures the entire operation. So instead of insuring one crop, like we insured sweet corn, this product would insure, you know, $250,000 worth of your farm, for instance, if that's historically how big your farm is, or $70,000, whatever. And the more diversified the farm is, the better subsidized it is. So therefore, the lower the premium. So the more diversified you are, the less it costs you, up to a certain level. So in order to sign up for this, you want to have Schedule F tax records for your farm activities and for how much you've made, right? Because you're insuring the revenue of your farm. So you need to be able to prove how much you've made in previous years. Seems like common sense. If you are a beginning farmer and you do not have 5 full years of Schedule Fs, you can use 3 years of Schedule Fs. But I think what's important to understand is that those, because of the date by which you have to sign up for whole farm revenue protection and the date where you have to file your taxes, it kind of ends up being more like 4 years of Schedule Fs. There are some special allowances for beginning farmers that may, where you may be able to use historical revenue from a farm that you helped with that was on that same property or something like that. So this is a great place to talk to your crop insurance agent. And those whole farm policies can cover all the crops, all the livestock that are produced by that farm. So it's not just for vegetables or not just for fruit, but it can be for, you know, for dairy, for added value crops, for, I believe it can be for added value crops. Whole farm revenue policies cover all kinds of crops and livestock and stuff that's produced by that farm. So this is not just a policy for produce growers or for fruit growers or vegetable growers, but it can also be used for very diversified farms where you may have produce and animals or and chickens or and eggs, or if you are just a beef farm, this could be a policy that you used as previously shown in the beekeeping slides. So a beekeeper who's just a beekeeper might choose to have whole farm revenue protection. So one of the other things that's really helpful to understand is that whole farm revenue protection protects the revenue from the farm from all kinds of losses. So in addition to losses that are covered by more traditional crop insurance like fire or hail or insect damage, something like that, whole farm revenue also protects from the kinds of market fluctuations or other issues that might have affected how well your crops sold and therefore how much revenue you've earned in that year. So for instance, if you ran a you-pick berry farm and you've always made $70,000 a year from this you-pick berry farm, and in this year it rains for every week in July, and nobody comes to your farm to pick, then you have this revenue protection would pay out for that loss to whatever level you're covered. So I think that's kind of an unusual kind of coverage and is something helpful to understand about how whole farm works. This has not been heavily adopted yet. So in New York State, usage is pretty low. As the slide says, there have only been 15 policies sold in 2017. We are helping to share information about it because it is aimed at, you know, very diversified growers, at market farmers, etc. But we're also sort of interested in doing some listening sessions and to talk with growers about why it, what could be changed about this program to make it work really well for them. If it isn't currently working and that's why people aren't buying it, then we want to know why and understand how to improve it. The other thing to understand about it is because it's a pretty new policy, not all crop insurance agents are going to be incredibly well-versed in how it works. So it may be helpful to understand a little bit more about it, to read through the tip sheets and stuff like that, so that you can approach your crop insurance agent and really be able to ask for exactly what you're looking for. And again, the Ag Analytics website from Cornell can help you kind of walk through whole farm and understand what kinds of premiums you'd be looking at, what kind of coverage you would get to understand the product better. And I think that's especially helpful with something so new where you might just want to do a little research at home before you talked to somebody. RMA would say that you should always go to your crop insurance agent and talk to them, but I think sometimes that feels a little intimidating to people and they want to just be able to research it and understand the products on their own at home. So Whole Farm is available in all New York counties, and that's true across the country as well. It's available everywhere. There are important dates, and these are mostly national dates as well. So the regular closing date is March 15th. So that's when you would need to apply and buy the when you would need to buy this policy by. catastrophic coverage is not available under this program. It does have a 50%, the base premium is 50%, is that 50% coverage. And it does also have replant coverage, which we'll talk about a little bit more in another slide. So replant coverage is where they help to cover some of the costs for replanting if you've been not able to get in because of weather, or if your crop has been seeded but because of weather is not going to be able to germinate. So there's replant coverage available under Whole Farm, and there are some specifics there about understanding that. Again, I think that is replant coverage is really interesting for a crop that you are only planting one time a year, for instance. But for something that you're seeding once a month or once every few weeks, it may be a little bit less useful. So this is a little bit of information about prevented planting or replant insurance. So if there's a very late spring and you're just not able to get your crop in, or if there has been torrential rains and all the seed washes away or something like that and you need to replant it. Many of these policies, with some exceptions, have a prevented planting clause or a replant clause. So that is a payment that's, as this says, typically 60% of the production guarantee that kind of helps to cover the cost of replanting or some other formula that's in your policy. So that's something to look into a little bit more. And there's, again, this great tip sheet from Cornell. So it really lays out how prevented planting coverage works. Either prevented planting or replant. Those are slightly different. So that kind of helps you understand exactly what that means. And again, that's available through Whole Farm, but it's also available through some of those multi-peril insurances as well. So things you might want to know. If you don't have production history, if you don't have any production history, you have to have some production history in order to qualify for Whole Farm. But if you want to have a multi-peril insurance and you don't have any production history, there are county yields that you can use to set the policy. There are some quality loss indemnities that are possible in New York State and presumably in other places as well. And they give the example that you might have quality loss due to, say, hail, so you still have a good yield of apples, but they look scarred in a way that you're not going to be able to get the real payment for them. So New York has had drought-related indemnities, but we also have lots of cold weather or excess moisture indemnities. That's going to vary, of course, across the country, but we, you know, that you might see similar things in the Southeast, drought or excess moisture. Lenders like crop insurance. We have a guidebook to FSA programs and to FSA loans. FSA loans do not require crop insurance unless you are using the crop as collateral for the loan. So in that case, you would need to have crop insurance on the crop itself. That can be a little bit tricky sometimes because there's not really a lot of crop insurance policies for, you know, your Tatsoi. In that case, your lender might require you to have a NAP for that. So, not all crop insurance products are available in every county. I think I touched on that a little bit earlier. You might have, for example, in Colorado, there's some counties that grow lots of peaches. And so there are crop insurance policies available for peaches in those four counties, but you might not be able to insure peaches in another county that has a less traditional history of growing that crop. Interested farms should contact a crop insurance agent, and I would say should also check out other tip sheets or RMA tip sheets or information from the Ag Analytics website to kind of get a sense of what their premiums might be and what kinds of crops are covered in their space. Like a lot of insurance policies, certainly like getting a loan or something like that, this is a little bit of a relationship building experience. So you're going to be building a relationship with your crop insurance agent, and hopefully they'll be looking out for you and you'll be able to ask them lots of questions. They'll help you understand the deadlines that are available or that are required. So there are just a couple of notes about record keeping for crop insurance. I spend a lot of time talking about food safety, which seems to be 75% record keeping. That's just a little food safety joke. But there's lots of record keeping that you might need to do in order to qualify for crop insurance. This picture shows some old-fashioned record keeping, which is also okay. If you are using a crop insurance product that's based on your actual production history, which we talked about earlier, right? So that would be whole farm. That would definitely be whole farm, but also some of those multi-peril insurances are probably going to be better if, or it's going to be a better coverage if you're using your actual production history. So you're going to need to be able to show your actual production history in order to be insured for that. So you want to make sure that you're keeping detailed records about your yields, all of that. You want to also probably keep records to show that you are doing your due diligence in terms of spraying or other kinds of things like that that you might need to do to, or covering a crop in order to show that you have tried to protect it against pest damage. They want to be sure that you are, you know, managing your farm adequately to manage risk as well. So you're keeping records of inputs and yield and revenue and loss. There are policies that cover organic production. Again, that varies from county, I think from county to county and certainly from state to state. I'll post a tip sheet on organic production crop insurance in New York State linked here. That crop insurance, those policies are the same. The payments are just a little bit different. So it's not a different kind of policy. It just has different levels for revenue and yield. So this is just a slide about actual production history. So it's either based on your actual yield history, if that's available, or if you don't have that actual production history, like your historical yields, it's based on this T yield that's a county average over the last 10 years. And if you don't have 4 years of actual records, they'll take other T yields. They'll use other T yields to help calculate that. But for most producers, it's best to use your own historical data if possible. And then there are other, there's other resources for you. There are articles and fact sheets and some other presentations and farmer testimonials that are available on the Cornell website. So that's a great place to check out stuff like that. Please contact us at NYFC. I'm Kara at youngfarmers.org. If you have questions about whole farm or pasture, rangeland, forage, I can even try to put you in touch with people who would be the right folks to talk to about other types of insurance policies. And I'm really interested in talking to growers who are trying to use whole farm or are curious about whole farm or are finding that they don't think it would work for them, because I really do think that this is an insurance option that is aimed at diversified growers, and I think that we want to make sure that it's working well for the people at whom it is aimed. I'll also say that crop insurance is it's taxpayer funded, and we want to be sure that our taxpayer money is going toward all kinds of agriculture and protecting all kinds of farms. So I think that's just another reason to make sure that some of these other types of insurance programs work for the broadest types of farmers in the United States. So hopefully that's helpful. Shoot me an email at kara@youngfarmers.org. It's Kara with a C. If you have any questions, or you can leave a comment here in our comment box.